According to conservative estimates, a 1.5 degree Celsius increase in global temperature will generate a global sea level rise of between 1.7 and 3.2 feet by the year 2100. Even if we collectively manage to keep global temperatures from rising, at least 570 cities and some 800 million people will be exposed to rising seas and storm surges. In our best-case scenario, we're going to see hundreds of major coastal cities submerged underwater. The worst-case scenario is unimaginable, which is why we need to rethink the way we're going to live in the future. In 2014, Kiribati, a neighboring cluster of islands in the South Pacific, purchased 8 square miles on Fiji. This was the world's first international land purchase meant for climate refugees. And in 2019, Indonesia's president, Joko Widodo, announced that Indonesia is going to move its capital from Jakarta to Borneo because of rising sea levels and the chronic annual flooding of Jakarta. It's clear that the climate is only going to get more dangerous over time. We can't risk losing cities every year to storms, floods, and wildfires. This is why a lot of agencies, including the United Nations, are now seriously looking at the possibility of floating cities. So, in today's episode, we'll be talking about the floating cities of the future and whether or not they're a viable solution to our ever-increasing climate problem. But before we start, make sure you smash that like button and subscribe to our channel for more awesome videos like this. Now, let's begin. The concept of floating cities is not a new one. We've always had floating cities in some rudimentary form. Think about the Gerald R. Ford-class aircraft carrier, which is the biggest aircraft carrier in the world with the capability to carry well over 4,000 people. Oil rigs and platforms can also be considered as floating mini-cities. These platforms host hundreds of workers at a time, living on board for months. Similarly, cruise ships sail all over the world and can house hundreds of people with every possible luxury of life on board. So, we already have some form of floating cities, but to take this to the next step, we need to think outside the box because time is not on our side. Climate change isn't going to slow down and coastal cities will bear the worst every year, so it makes sense to think ahead of time to create floating cities today that can ensure life carries on as normal in the future. The only possible danger that floating cities face is that of a hurricane or storm. This, however, can be easily averted by building up modular floating cities and then disassembling them and moving them into calmer waters until the storm passes through. Seems simple enough, right? Seasteading is the official term used for floating cities around the world. The Seasteading Institute, based in San Francisco, was founded by Patry Friedman, the grandson of renowned economist and Nobel Prize winner Milton Friedman. Patry believes that seasteading is the quickest and cheapest solution to deal with the threat of rising seawaters. The Seasteading Institute, however, is only a portal for research papers and advocacy. It's far from giving a working model to build a sustainable floating city. Attempts have been made in the past to create a floating city because, as we mentioned earlier, we don't really lack the resources. In 2011, a company named Blue Seed announced a project to create an entrepreneurial incubator on a cruise ship some 12 miles off the coast of San Francisco. The aim was to attract entrepreneurs to the cruise ship to collaborate on projects. Even Peter Thiel, the co-founder of PayPal, invested into the project. Unfortunately, though, this idea never really took off. Another company named Ocean Builder tried to turn a cruise ship into a floating city. The MS Satoshi, named after the elusive founder of Bitcoin, was all set to become the first floating city in the world before it too hit an iceberg. No insurance company was willing to insure the ship, and the project sunk before it could even set sail. Then, later in 2017, the Seasteading Institute signed a contract to build a floating city off the coast of Tahiti, but it was later scrapped by the government due to political reasons. So, while we clearly have the technical expertise to create a floating city, we seem to lack the funding and the will to follow through with any of these ideas. If we look at the past failures, we can see a common denominator in each failure. Every attempt has been made by a single company or a single country. But this is a problem that affects the whole world. We're not talking about one or two cities going underwater. We're talking about over 500 coastal cities worldwide. It's clear that any attempt to create a floating city should be made through a collective effort, because it's going to need a lot of funding and is something we will all benefit from. This is why the United Nations is probably the best platform to back any such project. The UN Habitat is a program set up by the United Nations to help countries achieve their sustainable development goals. It recently initiated a program in 2019 with Oceanix to build the Oceanix City, which will be a zero-waste, hurricane-resistant floating island. The Oceanix project will see researchers from MIT collaborating with designers from the Bjarke Ingels Group. The concept of this groundbreaking city consists of buoyant islands clustered together in groups of six to form mini floating villages. These clusters will then be repeated in multiples of six to form a 12-hectare village suitable for 1,650 full-time residents. Pretty clever if you ask me. They may not seem like much, but these hexagonal modules will also be able to withstand Category 5 hurricanes and tsunamis. The best part about the Oceanic City is its ability to be scaled up according to the needs of the population. As the population grows, more modules can be added to scale up the size of the city. A scale model of the Oceanic City is going to be put on display in the Futures exhibition at the Smithsonian's Art and Industries building in November this year. The buildings on the hexagonal module will be restricted to a height of 7 floors to keep the center of gravity low, and will be designed in a fanned-out fashion to maximize the roof area for solar panels. Hollow concrete buoys will be used to provide buoyancy, and stability to the modules and biorock technology will be used to create artificial reefs for marine life under the modules. The social, culture, and other activity hubs will be located at the center of the modules for easy access from all sides. To make it fully sustainable, locally sourced materials will be prioritized. Fast-growing bamboo will be used for construction, and it can be grown on the floating neighborhoods, producing a negative carbon footprint in the process. These modules are expected to be prefabricated on land and then towed to their final site, leading to reduced construction costs. This, paired with the low cost of leasing space on the ocean, creates a surprisingly affordable model of living. All these factors combined mean that affordable housing can be rapidly deployed to coastal megacities that need it most. Oceanic City is also going to recycle its food waste into compost that can be used in community gardens. Single-use packaging would be completely eliminated, and sewage would be treated in algae ponds. In other words, Oceanic City is going to completely reimagine the way we live today. There isn't currently a set date for when the first Oceanic City will be completed, but official reports indicate that the company is hoping to have the first city fully up and running by the year 2030. It is, however, also attracting its fair share of criticism as well. Although Oceanix has tested proof of concept by turning shipping containers into floating homes for some 300 students, building an entire city on water is a completely different challenge. It's not just about floating a city, but making it sustainable and livable for thousands of people on a daily basis. Many people have criticized the project for being too ambitious and failing to look at the needs of densely populated coastal cities like Jakarta, Mumbai, or Karachi, having populations well over 10 million. And since this project is being pitched to governments and not individuals, how are the developing nations that are facing the biggest risk from global warming going to fund these floating cities? Due to these reasons, many critics have termed the concept of floating cities as a vanity project for the elite. What do you think? After repeated failures, is the Oceanic City going to be a success? And if they can pull it off, would you be willing to live in a floating city? Let us know what you think in the comments down below, and like always, if you enjoyed the video, make sure you subscribe to our channel to stay up to date with all of our latest releases. Other than that, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.